Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the emergency fireside chat number 31 with our very special guest, David Jaffe. I'm your host, Brian, and I am joined by Scott and Allison, and as well as David Jaffe. Thank you for coming on the show today, David. I hope you're doing well.
I'm doing great, and I appreciate you guys having me. And I heard about the show today for the first time on Twitter, and people were like, oh, no, you should go talk to these guys. They're really cool. So I appreciate the opportunity.
Well, thank you very much. First off, before we get into the meat of this thing, how is your Mother's Day going?
It was good. We just kind of wrapped up here at the house and had people over, a bunch of people, and ordered a bunch of food. And it was really warm and good, and we just played a little Uno. Now the kids are running around, and I'm trying to finish with you guys and wrap up.
Oh, man, fucking Uno. I haven't played that since I was, like, a little kid.
Well, I had this game. I went to Barnes & Noble. We saw Civil War yesterday, and then there's a beautiful Barnes & Noble right next door. And so I picked up this game, Werewolf, or One Night Werewolf, or whatever. And I figured, oh, that'll be a great game to play, and then nobody wanted to play it. I'm like, no, it's not yet.
Wait, yeah. One Night Werewolf? What, is that the one where somebody at the table's a werewolf, and you have to figure out who it is, or something like
that?
Yeah,
it's like a great party game, and it was... Yeah,
it's like Town of Salem, kind of.
Yes, that's
same
right.
Same kind of thing, yeah. Same kind
and they concept. Have an app with it where the announcer is like, you know, all cool sound effects and stuff, so you don't have to worry about, everybody gets to close their eyes at the beginning, so you have to worry about, well, I'm trying to read the announcements and close my eyes. So it's pretty cool, but they wanted to play Uno, so we did that.
Oh, that's freaking sweet, man.
It's kind of like you put all your effort and love and passion into designing a really cool multiplayer mode, and people just play Team Deathmatch. You're like, fuck!
I totally get that. About, you know what, since we talked about games and stuff, and we know you're a game dev, but there might be people who watch that don't know, so could you tell us briefly what it is that you do, maybe what you're known for or whatever?
Yeah, sure. So I currently am a co-owner, lead designer at a company called the Bartlett Jones Supernatural Detective Agency, and the main thing we do among several is we make video games. We're working on a game right now called Drawn to Death for PlayStation 4, and then we're also I've also done, I'm mostly known for like Twisted Metal, was co-creator of that. Your fucking dog is cross-eyed, so I'm I'm looking at the dog and I'm kind of like, all right, I don't know if I should respond to your facial expressions, which look like you're like...
Oh, no. Well, the camera's not quite perfect.
So fucking weird. This is great. This is so great. I really should be on some sort of medicinal thing before I come onto the next episode, if you'll have me. So Twisted Metal and then God of War, mostly one. I was the creative director at Sony Santa Monica, and so I was the director, lead designer, and co-writer of the first God of War. And then a bunch of other things. But I've been doing this for about 20 years.
Okay. That's sweet. So yeah, I totally big fan of God of War and Twisted Metal, cool. Especially. I came up, that was my shit in the 90s. Just to sort of like get into the meat of this, so what happened? What I want to do is I want to get an idea of what the events were, and then I think we're going to try and figure out like why that might be, and I might have some light that I can shed on it, and we can like talk about that. But okay. First thing is first. This all came out because you posted a photo on Twitter and you had a comment with it. I can go get the photo too if you want. Hold on. Why don't you talk about what that was while I do that?
Yeah. So there was a. It wasn't like I had this photo. It was a picture in Huffington Post, which is a website I go to check out news and whatnot. And so it was a picture, or is a picture, and it was a news story about this really cool geeky prom photo. And, you know, I'm a big geek. I love being a geek. I love stuff like that. And I'm like, oh, I'm going to click that. What's that about? And I saw the picture, and it's basically, which hopefully your viewers can see in a second, it's basically an image of these, I don't know, it's like five. I think the guys are standing there. And their prom dates have sort of the guys are dressed in tuxedos, but the girls are kind of opening the guys' shirts, and each one of them has like a superhero insignia on the chest. So it's like you see the arc reactor of Iron Man and Captain America's shield and Superman's crest and blah 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 blah. There you go. Okay, you got it.
Mm-hmm.
And then and the women are all their dresses are pretty much coordinated. It's pretty cool if you look at Batman has the colors and all that matching the dress. And so I saw the picture and I immediately just I took a screen grab or shot the link out or whatever it was. And I'm sure you have that as well, but basically I was struck by what I felt was a very sexist image. And I tweeted out, way more, and I've since apologized for the language in the first tweet, which was really, it was sort of a faux outrage, sort of, isn't this stupid, isn't this sexist? I really love this as a geek, but as somebody who doesn't like sexist stuff, I can't get behind this, or whatever. But it was tailor-made for Twitter, and I assumed there would be a vast majority of people who were like, yeah, we agree, Jaffe, that's a stupid fucking picture. And honestly, it was like 90% of people were like, you're a fucking idiot, Jaffe, and we hate you. And so we don't think this is sexist, blah, 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 blah. And so that's pretty much what sort of opened the can of worms, which really, many people would tell you the can of worms didn't have to be a can of worms, but I like discourse. I like debate. I have zero problem, engaging in heated debate and also coming at it with an open mind to be told, oh, hey, I'm wrong. I can learn about this stuff. And I can, I was talking to my brother tonight who's here, and he's like, he doesn't see sexism in this picture, and that's mm-hmm. fine, but so anyway, it wasn't so much that the can of worms was necessarily about what I was initially tweeting about, which again was done so, not all the subsequent tweets, and I stand behind the first tweet in terms of what I was saying. How I said it was probably pretty dumbly inflammatory given that I, didn't realize I was going into a hornet's nest of people who didn't really believe what I believe. So, but anyway, yeah, so that was sort of the gist of it. And then I had just, we've been on and off Twitter all day just sort of, arguing, debating, discussing, insulting, which I like. I mean, I don't take too much of it personal. I think it's I think the subject matter I take seriously. I mean, the context of this for me was not that it matters. I still think it's a sexist photo. I don't think the people in it are sexist necessarily. There's no indication that these are sexist men or sexist women. The photographer's right. Probably not sexist. I don't think that is what is happening here. So I never suggested that, and I never suggested I would have no problem if my daughters, when they were of prom age, would do something like this. I have no issues with that either.
Mm-hmm.
But I do think the photo represents, or it's not a stretch to think the photo could very much represent societal norms that I find personally sexist, and that's what I was basically tweeting about. And some people got that. We had a nice, interesting discussion, although heated at times, which is fine, and some people just were like, the ones that really piss me off are like, why can't you let them have fun? I'm like, dude, fuck off. I'm not trying to get in their way of having fun. I've been on social media. I started with a blog back before God of War 1 came out. Okay, so I've been communicating with the internet and putting myself out there. Anybody who had any interest before they just jumped in and insulted me could have looked at over a decade of social media presentation of me, and they will know. I am not a guy who's going around looking for things to get offended by. I don't consider myself, someone who can't, enjoy a good vulgar joke. Most of my games are basically vulgar jokes. My current game allows you to shoot open someone's butthole and crawl inside and fight in it. Okay, so it's not like I'm – it does. And it's not like I'm some prude or something. It's just that I said, hey, I think this is sexist. And I said it stupidly, but I do think it's sexist. So I'll shut up now, at least for the moment. But that's not – oh, I wanted to tell you, though. So not that it matters. It's still sexist to me. But if context matters in terms of where my head was. So yesterday was Free Comic Book Day. So I had my daughters and I had a friend of theirs, and we went, and like I said, my brother's with us right now, and he went with us down there. And my youngest daughter, who you just saw, dancing around here, was 10. And she's always asking about Black Widow, or she wants to play video games that have women characters as the stars. We watch Supergirl religiously when it's on every Monday. And she loves that show. We watch anime together. We were really enjoying the first arc of Sword Art Online, and suddenly when, I forget the names of the characters, but the main female character starts becoming this damsel in distress and stops being this badass warrior, we clearly, both of us, but certainly her, lost interest and stuff. And so I was coming off a Free Comic Book Day where it was nice to see comics that were starting to reflect her interest. I was coming out of Captain America Civil War, which I took them to right after, and, you know, is that Black Widow, Dad? Is that Black Widow? You know, this, she always had an affinity for Black Widow and for the female superheroes and stuff. So my mind was already in this place of, like, I think it's cool and interesting that my daughter likes this world as much as I do, and I like sharing that with her. And then to see this picture, you know, my head wasn't in the right place to begin with, given that I don't like sexist things that I feel are sexist. That kind of pushed me over the edge and blah, blah, blah. So there you go. I'll shut up. Go.
No, that's totally fair, man. I wanted to get it. See, that was important because I wanted to get the context, because this is the thing. Like you were saying before, you know, it's not... You know, I went through your Twitter just to see if this was a pattern, and it doesn't appear to be a pattern. And, you know, as a game developer yourself, your games have come under scrutiny for being either, you know, sexist or something that you said for an ad or something that, you know, people thought were too violent or, you know, the themes are too mature or whatever. Mm-hmm. So it wouldn't really make sense that, you know, you would have to fight against that and at the same time be as sort of, you know, as easily bruised by it, right? So when I saw it, this is basically my experience, okay? So I was I saw it through social media. Somebody else had shared it. And my first reaction when I saw it was, I don't really think that that's sexist. But when I saw who shared it and was your tweet, I was like, wait, is this the same guy that, you know, had, like, gone after Steven Totillo in that one video, was, like, just ripped into him and then, like, stormed off? This doesn't sound like the same guy. So, and I looked it up and it was you, and then I thought, well, I think you're just, you know, you were dealing with a great deal of backlash. And so the thing I wanted to know was, were you surprised by that? Because I think that you were, it seems.
Yeah, I was. I mean, again, I mean, in retrospect, you know, I probably was more inflammatory with the initial post. But that aside, though, I was surprised because I shouldn't have been. I mean, here's what I would say. If I had posted the picture in a less hyperbolic way and I would have said, hey, you know, I think this just strikes me as sexist, y'all. What do you think about this? Am I thinking about it too much, whatever?
Yeah.
Then I would have been surprised if the response had been what it was. But given the fact that if you look at my opening tweet, and it's clearly just like the sky is falling, you know, which I really wasn't. I mean, I remain serious about feeling it's a sexist image, but, you know, the sky wasn't falling, and I definitely shouldn't have presented it that way, because that's, I think, what created so much of the animosity towards me. Because, again, the vast majority of people that were coming out of the woodwork, you know, to sort of insult me or tell me I was an idiot or whatever, they weren't followers and people who, I mean, there are people I'm like, who the fuck is this? I've never, you know, seen this person on Twitter in my life, you know, people mm-hmm. coming from, you know. So, you know, it clearly had struck a nerve with people who I had not been afforded the opportunity to build any kind of credit in the bank with, sort of mentally or intellectually, where they would say, like you said, this isn't a match. It's weird that this guy would be saying this. Let's figure that out. Whereas most people were just like, you know, the thing that bothered me the most was just a sense of, I became, for today, sort of the poster child for all of these people who, rightly or wrongly so, and that's a different debate, happy to have it, happy to discuss it. I think it's fascinating, but for rightly or wrongly so, feel as if, you know, what they call political correctness has done too much damage to their day-to-day lives, and I became the receptacle for all of that hate. And it was just kind of like, well, I posted one thing. You don't know me. You clearly don't follow me on social media. You talk about, everybody's like, you'll get upset by anything. And I think maybe what they're saying is there are people that they know who share a lot of the views that I might share, who might go off on every single thing, and they're looking for sort of ghosts around every single fucking corner, and that's not me, but I became that for a lot of people, and that was annoying, because I'm like, you know what, after I kind of talked back the initial hyperbole and sort of inflammatory language of post number one, I was genuinely interested in having a conversation about this, because the Kotaku thing that you bring up, you know, people, again, is, you know, first off, half people are like, you fucking asshole, you laid into to Ben Kachera and all this shit, and now you're doing, I'm like, you're a fucking idiot. Because I didn't lay into Ben Kachera. I've told people over and over and over and over, he was the reporter who was there when I laid into Kotaku and Stephen Totilo. But people can't even bother to get the facts straight, right? And so, but anyway, so obviously that kind of rubs me the wrong way. But the point being is that when I spoke to the reporter who wrote these terrible things about me for that Kotaku article, my mind was still open. I said, hey, let's jump on a call together. You can record it. Put it up on Kotaku, the whole conversation. Let's talk about this. I don't have to be right about this. What am I doing wrong? And at the end of it, it was clear that she didn't understand the difference between sexism and misogyny. And I said to her, I said, it's okay to call the statements I made sexist, because you know what, you're right. And I apologize for those, because the thing that really made me sad was it never occurred to me when I was speaking about Twisted Metal players that I should also include women in that group. And it wasn't because I was some devious asshole. It was because in all of my correspondence with Twisted Metal fans, I can't really think of many, if not maybe one, who called herself Killer Green. Besides her, I can't think of one person who was a woman who played that game. Doesn't mean there weren't tons. It just, that was not my experience talking to people who played Twisted Metal. And when she pointed that out to me, I said, yeah, that was, you know, you're right about that. That was absolutely sexist. That was wrong to sort of put that out there. And I apologize publicly, and I apologize to her about that, and I mostly apologize to Twisted Metal fans, men and women. I said, but that has nothing to do with what you're really accusing me of, which is misogyny. I said, you have no indication that I'm a misogynist. I am vulgar. I am crude. I was talking about blowjobs. I was talking about all of these things that are absolutely not family-friendly, primetime conversations for a lot of people to have.
Blowjobs are awesome, but go on.
Well, right. So, but I'm just saying that it's just kind of like, well, especially you, because, you know, you can do one for yourself because you're a guy. And it's the worst fucking sound in the world. The reason, you know, I don't let Ace, who's running around here somewhere, sleep in my bed, and he really wants to, is that fucking sound you fucking dogs make. It's like, and it's so true. Gross. It's so fucking gross.
But it hits the sweet spot, though.
It hits your sweet spot. It makes me want to vomit on my pillow. So it's disgusting. But anyway, the point being is that you threw me off. It happens when you tend to talk.
You said about you were being crude and stuff, and then super crude. But go on.
So vulgarity, crudeness. I'm a fan of that stuff. I get that it's not everyone's cup of tea. I think it's funny. I like to push people's buttons because people I think are a little too uptight. And I was like, you know, so I copped to it being sexist. I apologize. My mind was open. I learned something, and I appreciated that. And that's what I thought would happen with this today, where if somebody disagreed with me, it's like, all right, maybe I'm wrong. Let's have a conversation. My daughter doesn't think I'm right. I showed my 12-year-old. I said, do you think this is sexist? And she's like, no, idiot.
Yeah.
You know, she didn't call me an idiot. But she's like basically looking at me like, no, why would you? You know, so I don't have to be right about this, but I absolutely definitely think it's – I'm not – I've earned enough credit in the bank that I think if I put a statement out there you know, it doesn't mean that I'm just fucking making shit up. I clearly have an opinion that if you're interested in such things, let's talk about it.
All right. Allison wants the floor, but we can get into that if you like. Allison?
Getting it into?
You know, we could talk about whether or not it's a, you know, the image is actually sexist, and then...
Oh, yeah, I first wanted to say that...
Before we do that, though, I have to ask Allison, are you in a panic room?
No. I'm actually in the sort of the tool and chemicals area of our shop.
Okay. So okay. Good.
It's not a panic room.
All right. Sorry.
No, the fire hasn't spread this far. Don't worry.
All right.
And we had a long discussion, so it's really unlikely to.
Excellent. Sorry. Go ahead.
No, I just wanted to say, to be honest, when I saw all of this stuff being directed at you, I really like. I understand the anger coming from that side. But at the same time, there was a conversation I had about 2 years ago, actually a year and a half ago, with a man. I'm not going to say his name, but he is a very large webcomics creator. And I had the conversation because we were talking about Honey Badger Radio at an event that actually the same expo people who kicked me out at another event put on, but that's another story. Anyway, so I was talking to him at that event, and we were talking about his experiences and the fear he felt deviating from the party line of basically what were left progressive social justice warrior types. And he told me, he said to me, you know, I don't feel any fear disagreeing with you, but I do feel fear disagreeing with them. And that should say something to me, but I'm too much of a coward to really draw the conclusion. And what I'm seeing here is that the other side is starting to make it terrify people from actually talking. And I don't like it. If somebody says something you don't agree with, pull it out. Figure out what exactly they are actually saying, what their position is, what their logic is. Engage with the logic. But the amount of vitriol, I don't want to support any side that creates a situation where people are afraid to talk about things that they want to talk about or that they perceive or any conclusions that they draw. That's the exact opposite of what I want to see. Even if it is creates a situation where social justice warriors or people who think something is sexist actually can talk about it. Now, if we can both, I mean, I would really appreciate if that side toned down their rhetoric quite a bit, because that's the problem I have with them. I mean, more than anything, more than the conclusions they draw, I have a problem with the fact that they ostracize people, they kick them out of conventions, they go after their job, they silence people. What they believe is separate from the horrible actions they take when you deviate from their party line. But I don't want to see this.
You're talking about the Gamergate party line? I'm not sure. I don't really know your website, so I don't know.
We are more Gamergate aligned. We're more Gamergate aligned.
So which side are? Oh, you're talking about the guys who are anti-Gamergate.
I'm talking both, basically, at this point.
Okay.
The anti-Gamergaters were the ones who got me and my comic banned from a convention.
Okay.
The Gamergaters are the ones who are now sort of getting really up in arms about the fact that you called a photo sexist. But it's like, there's a similarity there. Yeah. People should not be afraid to talk about what they want to talk about. Even if you think it's stupid. And to get to the point where you're starting to stigmatize and censor and make people afraid of speaking with each other in public about their ideas. I don't want to see that. And to be honest, I'll bring this out. Of all of the people involved in the Gamergate controversy, I lost a lot by supporting Gamergate, personally. And I don't want to see Gamergate become even a shadow of what we were fighting, which is this is what I see. He shouldn't, like, even if you disagree with David, he shouldn't have to be subject to vitriol, a continual stream of vitriol, and maybe even his position isn't even quite that different than, or that social justice warrior. Don't create demons, and don't go after them with pitchforks. Just have calm conversations, and I know that I'm pissing everyone off with this, but that's, I mean, think about it. This is coming from me, and I don't hate to bring this up constantly, but, like, I stood up for Gamergate in a public place, and I got fucking slammed for it. And I don't want to see that. I don't want to see Gamergaters become that. And I just wanted to say that. So, and I'm sorry that happened to you, David, regardless of...
No, I'll say a few things in response to that. I mean, the first one being that I think it's important to remember, at least for me, that the vast majority of this, for the vast majority of these folks, whatever side, you know, quote side you're on, is entertainment. I mean, it's somebody today was just, somebody tweeted me a great picture of like a little cat paw pulling a person's hand away from the computer. It was like subtitled something like "No more tweets for the day."
Yeah,
no
step
more
tweeting. Away from it. Yeah.
Step away from the tweet. You know, yeah. But I was like, dude, I'm having fun with this. I don't insult people. I don't think that's fun. I don't think the things that you're talking about in regards to like actually trying to come after people's jobs and things like that, I'm not talking about that stuff. But I think, you know, the vast majority of this is just people taking the piss, and it's stupid. It's just stupid. Sort of, you know. So if you take that part out and you actually look at what's left, which is the serious issues being discussed, I would say that, yeah, the problem is that, and you see it in, you know, at a meta level, you see it in politics today, where you see on the left and the right, you see so many people claiming to be about freedom and about free speech, but it really what they're claiming is they're really only supportive of that free speech if the speech is speaking to what they already agree with and what they believe in. But if someone else, whether you're liberal or conservative, has a different opinion, then they'll find a reason to say, oh, well, it's not a free speech issue, it's this, that, or the other. But ultimately, it's they're saying something that they don't like. And so the argument that they had used to protect themselves no longer works when someone else uses the same argument. And so I do think that happens with the Gamergate thing. And I mean, even with Gamergate, it was so funny because let's assume out of all the people I interfaced with that considered themselves part of that group, there were maybe 20% that I felt I could have a real conversation with. The other 80% were like, it's like you're either a fucking lockstep, goose-stepping Nazi, you know, to this agenda, or you're not. And I'm like, well, no, it really isn't that simple. I believe in this and what you guys are saying. I think I believe in this and what you guys are saying. I'm confused about this, blah, 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 blah. And it was like there's no shades of gray. It was just, well, you're either with us or against us. At that point, when that's 80% of what you're hearing at the time from a lot of the people who would hashtag Gamergate, it was like, fuck this. This is, you know, I'm, and it's like, oh, we lost Jaffe. You didn't fucking lose me. I never signed up a goddamn contract with you people, whether it's Gamergate or anti-Gamergate. I'm like, look, I have an opinion, and that's all it is. And sometimes it's going to align, just like sometimes my opinion aligns with conservatives, and sometimes it aligns with liberals. But mm-hmm. I have a right to not have to sort of put myself in a box, just like everybody else does, and say I'm either pro-Gamergate or anti-Gamergate. And so I agree with you is that, you know, you're basically starting to see the same tactics that they were accusing the left side of. Gamergate, if you're talking about at least what happened to me today, yeah, it's like, dude, what the fuck? Why I can't have an opinion that you don't like? So I think that's speaking to what you're saying, but...
Yeah, well, it's speaking to what I'm saying. However, I will make a caveat that the anti-Gamergaters do seem to have a great deal more clout with media and also academia.
And well, but how much of that matters? At this point in 2016, I mean, media, video game media ain't what it used to be. You know, I mean, the fact is I'm on this show because you guys seemed interesting and there was a reputation, even though one guy, which I appreciated, you know, I'll take it from all sides, but one guy was like, oh, don't go on their show, go on their show. But most people were like, no, they're a really cool show. They're up and coming. They have lots of good opinions and stuff. And I'm talking to you guys, and I love talking to anyone on the internet who has interesting things to say and share. And so the idea that Kotaku holds any kind of weight anymore, I don't really think it matters. You know, I just don't think there's that kind of influence. I hear you. I think you're right that the sort of anti-Gamergaters tend to be on that side. But to be fair, a lot of it is I think Gamergate did a really bad job at expressing what they were about. And I know they liked, very much like Occupy Wall Street, they prided themselves on being a leaderless movement, but it kind of bit them in the ass because anybody could hashtag Gamergate and there was nobody out there sort of on the Gamergate side policing, and I use that, you know, inflammatory verb intentionally because I know that was the thing they were up against. They didn't like that. But it's like, well, look, guys, if you don't have an agenda, if you don't have a group of people who are meant to sort of carry that flag and represent you, of course you're going to be taken less seriously because anybody can claim to be part of your group and fuck up the whole thing for everybody else.
Sorry, Brian, just to, like, maybe I could put a little bit of a human face on some of the issues that Gamergate faces.
Yeah.
In 2015, I actually purchased a booth in summer of 2014 with the Calgary Expo. I did a fundraiser to get the rest of my team, Brian, Karen, Hannah, Mike.
Is your webcomic?
Oh yeah, this is my webcomic. Okay. Oh well, it was. I also had some print comic, print books as well.
Okay.
And part of you know, we did this fundraiser, and I said that, you know, we'll if the fundraiser makes it, I will thank Gamergate by flying a Gamergate flight. And it had the Gamergate colors or the Gamergate logo and Stand Against Censorship on it. And I put it up
on the airplane.
No, not on there.
In the booth.
In the booth.
Oh, I think you said you'd fly a Gamergate flight. I'm like,
no, Allison can actually fly. Okay. No,
I can. No. I said I would put it up at the booth as a thank you, for having supported us. And I mean, there was some other stuff. Like, I went to a Women into Comics panel, and I said some stuff. Actually, what I said is that we need to focus on making the stuff that we want. I said, I'm a men's rights activist. That got me behind the eight ball. And then I said, I think we need to focus on men's issues, because it, not just for men's sake, but also because it challenges the notion that women are victims. And because of those two things, mostly, I think, a lot of it was the Gamergate flag, I was forced to pack up my booth. Okay. And it was a booth that took 5 hours to put up, and I was forced to pack it up in about 15 minutes. So we ended up a lot of destruction.
We were only up for one day, too.
We were only up for one day. Yeah. And
when you say you were forced, this is probably a rehash for most of the listeners, but it's new to me. You mean, like, the people who ran the convention came to you?
Yes. The people at the convention forced as in the director of exhibitors came with another executive plus security guards to kick us out.
And that was something in the contract you had with them, that they could, at their discretion, do that?
Not technically. They were supposed to investigate and determine whether or not charges were correct or not. At least that's what they said in their contract. But okay. So they came with security guards. They kicked us out in part because of the Gamergate flag. They had cops waiting for us, although we never got to that state. And subsequently, they published, the group that was, we think, behind this whole thing, published an article that claimed that I went to the exhibition under false pretenses, under a false name, but our name was on the placards, on our cards, everywhere. It was in I have a newspaper with our name in it, indicating what booth we were. It was the Mary Sue that wrote this article. They said that we went under false pretenses. They said we hijacked a panel. And they said they said a whole bunch of other stuff. We're harassers and whatever else. And that one article from the Mary Sue, from the anti-Gamergators who didn't want us there, went almost all the way across Western Canada, all kinds of local and I think even maybe a couple national newspapers carried the information from that article, even though it was verifiably false. Like, I could have shown them the placard with my name, with the name of Honey Badger Radio on it, and I could have shown them the email exchanges, and I could have put up the audio from the actual event where it showed that I didn't harass anyone. I asked to speak to a topic that was brought up by one of the panelists, and I spoke to it. And despite all of this evidence, this one article ended up being spread throughout the entire news media of Western Canada, basically. And it didn't really hit me what that did to me or my name until like a couple months later, when I worked up the courage, because I had been trying to get my comics into stores in my hometown in Saskatoon and other places, and I worked up the courage to talk to one of the employees at a store that I had actually developed a relationship with, and she was carrying my comics. And the first thing I noticed is that she was really excited about my comics because I was a local talent or whatever. She'd taken down all of the posters that she put up to advertise my comic, and when I talked to her. I had talked to her for a while and be like, you know, well, everybody says that I'm a horrible person, but what is it that really that I say that's so horrible? And she said she had to admit that, but she only took like 1/4 of the comics that she originally took. And she had been really gung-ho about me bringing her comics before this happened. But she decided from all of this media that there was something wrong with me now, that I was a harasser, I was a fraud. I was some sort of part of a hate group, and it's like that really hit me, because this was a person that I had sort of, it wasn't necessarily a friendship, but it was an acquaintance, and we were friendly, and we had worked together, and this is how she saw me. This is how somebody who actually knew me personally saw me after they read those news media articles. Now, I can't imagine how people who don't know me, who never met me, in that community. Think of me. In fact, I do know because I had like comics, like bigger comics creators tweeting about how horrible I was, and I'd never met them at all. And it was like that is the power of this media, and that's essentially that's one of the things that Gamergate opposes is just that. The fact that they never fact check, like no stage in all of those steps did anyone stop and say, hey, maybe we should talk to this person and get her side and look at the evidence that she could present. Now, at no state did they, except for alternative media like The Rebel, and it was like, or libertarian media. And it was, this is exactly it. This is what Gamergate formed because of. Because the media just takes a narrative and runs with it and doesn't fact check it. And I know that you're saying that it doesn't matter, but it mattered to me. Well, I mean, it had a huge effect on my life.
So, wow, that's a heck of a story.
Yeah, but I don't want to get too much into this story.
No, but I mean,
it's really about you.
It's whatever. But I mean, it's a heck of a story. I appreciate you sharing it. Clearly, it still cuts deep, and I understand how it would. When I say it doesn't matter, I know I'm referring more to the fact that ultimately, all of this, and this is no news to you or anyone watching this, all of it's obviously driven by money and fear of not having any money. And I guarantee you, or I would have to imagine, that you make a comic, your next comic or whatever, if it becomes the next big thing, suddenly you'll be surprised how fast all will be forgiven. Because they don't really care. Because if they cared, they would fact check. If they cared, they would actually reach out to the opposition of the person they're writing about and say, this is more than just a sensationalist clickbait headline. I need to figure out the facts before I report it. And what it allows me to do is kind of figure out in the media the people who I choose to follow. And like Totillo, I'm friendly when I see Totillo from Kotaku. But, I even asked him a while back. We had a private conversation, which I won't share the details, but the gist of it was pretty much he wouldn't go so far as to say his reporter was wrong. But it was clear that, he probably would have handled things a lot differently now than then. And I said, you should retract the story. Because, you Google my name, my kids Google my name, one of the first 10 things that comes up is Kotaku saying I'm a misogynist. Could you do that? No, they wouldn't do that, And so for me, it's just kind of like, you find the people you can trust online, you find the sources, and you just keep working. And I know that sounds like, it doesn't lessen the blow that you clearly felt and feel from that, because it's a terrible thing to have happen to anyone. I'd say that sucks. That's our world. It ain't going to change for a long time until we figure out how to sort of regulate capitalism and educate the populace better so they can sort of actually begin to be educated enough to make voting decisions that aren't, in the best interest of only the corporations. I mean, I hate to get on a tirade, but ultimately all of this is about that. And so it sucks, but hopefully it hasn't deterred you from following your dreams and passions and making your comics. I can't imagine it would have, or if it would have, I hope you don't let it do that anymore.
Well, Allison, were you going to respond to that? Or
No, I understand what you're saying. The thing is that, I know, and I have, I'm not going to sit in that state of being in the inability to move on. I'm just saying that I would prefer that I want to work towards a world in which that is at least less likely to happen.
Okay, I agree, but let me ask you a question, though. So, if that, and I believe you, if that was, or given that that was a percentage of people who waved and carried the Gamergate flag, felt the way that you feel, why do you think it was so hard or difficult for Gamergate to say, you know what, we have this message, we think it's important, it's getting drowned out, it's getting... it's decomposing in front of our very eyes,
sure,
because
sure.
It's not being nurtured in a way that will affect change the way that we're so passionate about. Why do you think that movement was unable to sort of, you know, take that energy and passion, very noble desires, and direct it into a more successful movement.
I'd like this? To. Oh yeah, I was going to respond to it too, but you go ahead, Scott. Okay.
Well, from my standpoint, basically what we saw. I used to work for Destructoid, so I see it from both sides. But what we saw was that what websites places that people were congregating and actually having conversations were being literally shut down. Destructoid, they shut down their forums entirely. They just shit canned the whole thing. You saw this happening across the board. I mean,
were you at Destructoid at the time?
No, I haven't worked there since like 2010. So
okay. Why did they shut it down? Was it because it was just getting too flamey?
That's kind of a complicated thing, and I don't like want to get into that too much, just because I don't know all the details, and I don't want to say that they did this thing because of this reason and all that sort of thing. So
okay,
but they basically shut down their forums. I just have second information about it, so it's like I don't want to speak about it like I know exactly what happened. So, but they shut down their forums, and it was related to the things that were happening. And this was kind of like par for the course across the net. The places where people were trying to come together, trying to have these conversations, they were getting the kibosh put on them left and right. So it wasn't a matter of so much why didn't people in Gamergate just do this? It was that the ability to have a voice was being taken away. So it was a very volatile situation at the time. So like yourself personally, you have a following. You've worked in the industry for a long time. You have a voice because you have built it. You have made it a thing. But just Joe Averageman, Jane Averageman, whoever, their voice is it's a forum. It's a blog post. It's a whatever on a site. But when these sites start shutting those down, yeah, it's a radio show now. so. The voices of just the average kind of consumer and gamer were being shut down, just plainly, bluntly. So it wasn't a matter of not being or not wanting to; it was just a matter of being able to. So having that right kind of curtailed. So that's kind of the quick and dirty of it.
Okay. I mean, for what it's worth, and it may be of value to hear this, or maybe you've heard it before, but for what it's worth, as somebody who always kind of straddled the line being pro and anti Gamergate. It never felt that way to me. It always felt like Gamergate had a really hard time of sort of communicating their message in a way that was palpable and sort of, not professional, but sort of digestible enough to get people who weren't already engaged with them on board. And it didn't feel like it was because, I'm not saying it wasn't, I'm just saying from my perspective how it felt looking at it from the outside. It felt more like it was because, and I get that maybe it was the media portraying this, but if so, they did a wonderful job of making it sound like Gamergate was more often than not violent, making death threats, being a bunch of sort
hold
of.
Hold on, Scott. I can respond to that, but go ahead.
Let me finish. So I'm not suggesting it was. I'm just telling you that was. Whether that was true or not true, that was what was communicated to someone who didn't have a dog in the fight. I heard a lot of the things Gamergate talked about, and I was like, yeah, I agree with that. I agree with that. I agree with that. And then I would hear a lot of people saying really awful, horrible things online to people, and they would hashtag it Gamergate or not a shield or whatever it was, and I'd be like, oh, well, that kind of puts a bad taste in my mouth for that organization. What's going on? So that was my view of it.
Well, no, and that's fair, but to speak to that point, though, too, there was a lot of noise happening. People, because at the core, all of it, it's a hashtag, so anybody can use it. But no, you're right, there was a lot of noise, there's a lot of nastiness happening, in association with the hashtag and such. So, no, I totally understand that, absolutely.
Well, there's a lot of anger, right? Like, the thing is, and I didn't really want this to just be about Gamergate, but I think that we're just here now. There are a few things I want to speak to. One is Gamergate actually did get a lot of things accomplished, but the press will never report on it because that would mean that they would have to admit that they were not being ethical, that they were engaging in very bad practices, and not just the press, but also developers were going after them. They would, you know, write blog posts and they'd criticize them openly, or they put stuff in, you know, their games, or when they get localized for the States, or when they would dub, you know, make a dub for an anime or something, they would take jabs. I mean, there was an, what was it? There was an SVU episode that was devoted to slamming Gamergate, right? Do you see that? Okay. So, I mean, the whole, there was, the Gamergate was a leaderless movement, which there were many times that people within wanted to say, you know what, I think we should get organized and go come under one banner or one flag. But the problem with doing that is that that's how you can very easily become, you lose focus on what you're trying to do. And the thing is, as a hashtag, it basically remained a consumer revolt. And a lot of people talk about Gamergate as though it's a past tense thing, but it's actually still being discussed. But the thing is that Twitter has actually shadow banned the hashtag itself. So while there are still people talking about it, you can't see it. It won't trend anymore because they've actually eliminated that, Not Your Shield, and other, you know, hashtags that the Twitter Safety Council or whatever, it's the alpha version of that, has actually put into place. But Gamergate has cost Gawker a great deal of money because they were emailing their, you know, advertisers and so on. They have created new media. There's websites like Niche Gamer, goodgamers.us, I think. I don't know if it's still around, though. But I go to, like, Niche Gamer and Tech Raptor and stuff, and they're supportive. You know, they get where it's coming from. There's even, like, an adult one called Lewd Gamers. And this is, like, basically what's happening is people are building new media because old media is not serving them anymore.
And I think that, and it's funny because that is what I would always say when I would get into discussions with Gamergate people. They're like, we're going to take their advertising dollars away. And I was just like, you know, I totally agree with what you guys are trying to do when it came to those elements of improving media.
Yeah.
But I was just like, why not just make sites that speak to what it is that you think are important? And if there's enough people who agree, they will show up, it will monetize, you'll be fine. And these other things will be relics and they will be dinosaurs. So it's good to hear that you're saying that is actually happening.
Yeah, they are building new media, but I think it was important to send the message that, because this is the thing, what I find interesting, okay? Gaming and geek culture has been preached at, chastised, and shamed, and otherwise criticized as a culture. Gaming culture has been, and it's been dealing with this on all fronts since like the 1970s, like with Dungeons and Dragons. It was like, oh, Dungeons & Dragons is basically promoting, you know, Satan worship. And then you move into video games in like the 80s and 90s. Oh, it's promoting violence. It's the reason why we have school shootings. You know, and Jack Thompson would come out and he would talk about how unhealthy this stuff was. And when he did that, and other sort of senators from like the religious right would come out and they would have problems with gaming, right? Games media and game developers would stand by the gamers and say, yes, that's fucked up. Here, we're going to put Jack Thompson in this Mortal Kombat game so you can actually, you know, do a fatality on him. We're going to, you know, we're going to show them that we don't put up with that shit.
Sometimes they would.
Yeah.
Sometimes you had bullshit at the ESRB. Sometimes when you had the executives back in the 16-bit days going up in front of the Senate and talking about how, you know, sometimes it was just like they were almost flattered to be insulted by people of such a prestigious position as the government. They were like, whatever we can do to make you guys happy.
Yeah.
I didn't feel, you know, but I hear you. It was better in that.
Well, sense. On the plus side, though, the discussion at least took place. You know, like I can remember when, you know, rock and roll was coming under threat and Frank Zappa went and spoke in front of, you know, a bunch of goons or whatever, made his case. They allowed that to take place. But when it came time to accuse games and gamers of being misogynist, which is, you can find evidence for that in several websites, which, by the way, a lot of people were very, very, they were hurt by that because, you know, again, this is like a unique case when it comes to gaming and games media, because you have the people that are supposed to be on your side accusing you of stuff, you know, essentially putting this terrible label on you, which, of course, you wouldn't actually, it wouldn't bother you if you actually were a misogynist. Like, if I was really a misogynist and somebody accused me of being a misogynist, I'd say, yeah, of course, I don't give a fuck, you know.
No,
and I drink my brandy and slap my wife on the ass. But
that's right. That happens
because I'm not that person, it bothers us, right?
Yep.
And,
that's right.
And then on top of that, they silence them, they kick them out of forums, they, you know, and this sort of stuff just makes that group, you know, more angry, because it's like nobody wants to talk to us. The people that we're supposed to trust, they don't have our back. And it's actually kind of unique, because at least from what I know, no other area of hobby or interest, like whether you're into sports or fishing or Playboy magazine or, you know, fitness or porn or whatever, no other place will you get, like, you know, go to media or go to websites or go to content creators and they'll shame you for liking what they make or what they review or talk about. Only, that seems to be the case, only in this culture does this happen.
Oh, wait, let's correct that. All you Honey Badger listeners, you should be ashamed. You're ashamed for listening to us.
Yeah. So, I mean...
I think there are some very valid points there. And I've been on the receiving end of that, of those accusations, which, you know, back in 2012, I'm on record as just saying, fuck Gawker, and I've enjoyed watching their empire kind of begin to crumble because of the Hulk Hogan thing.
Well, but Gamergate started that ball rolling because they cost them six figures in 2014. And in a way, like, this is the thing, too, and I'm sorry to cut you off, but GG doesn't necessarily take pleasure in watching them burn, under the assumption that Nick Denton and the rest of those guys would have came out and said, you know what, we were wrong about you guys, because you're our audience, you guys pay our bills, and we shouldn't make you guys look like assholes, and we shouldn't slander you in our hit pieces about gamers. We shouldn't be talking about how, you know, the label of gamers should be, you know, thrown under the bus or whatever. We should not have done that.
Are you talking about the Leigh Alexander thing where she talked about gamers?
Yeah, Leigh Alexander, who essentially organized the whole thing. And this is another thing, is I can send you a link.
You know I've laid into her a bunch and we hate each other. I mean, we've gone at it.
She blocked me before I even got a chance to talk to her. But
I can't stand her. I cannot stand her.
Welcome to the club.
She doesn't work there anymore anyway, but, you know, at the time...
I hate to say that, because I'm sure at a human level, she's a good person.
Nope. I can tell you from first-hand experience, not so much.
Okay. Well, maybe not.
Well, I won't judge her as a person.
That's just my opinion. We'll just leave it at that.
I appreciate that. But, I mean, I hate to be so mean to someone, but she's definitely never really come across as... You know, the thing that always bothered me about her work was that it was so, like, look, I don't consider myself the smartest person in the room at all times or even most times. And my brother, who's sitting right over here, will tell you, I don't think he believes me when I say, no, you're a lot smarter than I am. He's incredibly smart. And usually when we're in the same room, it's like, yeah, you're an asshole because you're smarter than I am on a lot of things and more research on a lot of things, okay? But when it came to entering a debate and a discussion with Leigh about a lot of her stuff, it was just like her mind was made up. There was no desire to have a real conversation. And because my games had vulgarity and brutality and overt sexuality and overt violence, she couldn't fathom the fact that that was coming from a mind of someone who went to college and who did a thesis and who votes and is politically engaged and reads all kinds of I just must have been Satan. Mm-hmm. And everything that I did must have had sort of just nothing but stupid urges behind it. And I just found that incredibly offensive.
I would make the argument that I think that in the case with many of these journalists, people like Leigh Alexander, and lots of the guys at Gawker, Destructoid, Rock, Paper, Shotgun, Joystick, 1UP, whatever, all these places that we're dealing with, I think that a lot of those journalists didn't really want to be games journalists, but they had journalist degrees. They didn't actually like that culture, but they were journalists and they had to get work. So they would go in there, and then what they would do is they'd bring their politics into their shit. And you know, the many of the websites wouldn't differentiate between an op-ed and like something that's supposed to be a preview or a review. For people who like those games, like if someone's gonna review for you a God of War game, you don't want someone that's like a super like right wing Puritan Christian type that doesn't like blood violence or, you know, gods that are not the one God in any medium whatsoever reviewing your game, because they're
I don't. But if I run as the creator and the co-creator, but as the person who runs the website, if I have no scruples and morals and interest in being professional and sure. I just want to make money, yeah. you sure as shit right that I'd love to get the Pope to review God of War.
Yeah, exactly, right? <You know? laughs> And that's just it. Like, but the gamers that are thinking about buying God of War are not those people. So it doesn't actually serve your customers. I'm not saying that
absolutely, but that's not true, though. That's that the problem is that most, you know, and I throw myself in this group as well. It's like, it serves the customers. Do you know why? Because the customer's behavior is indicative of the fact that they're being served, because guess what? They click on it like a motherfucker.
Mm-hmm.
You know, gamers will go, oh my God, did you fucking see this? And then suddenly it gets a gajillion hits, and if I was running one of these sites, I wouldn't do it because I couldn't sleep at night, you know, doing that just for clicks. It would have to be good work as well. But a lot of people don't feel that way who run these sites, and they're just like, well, they're clicking on it. Give me more of that shit, Totillo. Give me more of that bullshit.
Oh, yeah, because, well, that's, you know, one of two ways you can get traffic to your website. One is, you know, you're telling them, like, you're basically aiming it at the people that want to read your stuff, so they're going to get a good feeling out of it, like they're going to read a review for a game they're interested in or whatever. But what really drives traffic is when you piss them off. Because mm-hmm. they're going to get mad, they're going to write a comment, they're going to share it with other people. You're like, look at this shit, and then they're going to share that, and it's going to get them more hits. And that's sort of like, you know, I think, anyway, at the root of where all this clickbait stuff comes from.
No, yeah. I think you're right, and I think it goes back to, again, it all, for me, not to be a broken record, but it goes back to education. I think kids should be educated to, you know, I think media education should be a crucial part of educating this generation of kids and coming up, because mm-hmm. the idea, people need to know when they're being taken for a ride. People need to know, yeah, if you click that, let me show you from your mouse click, let me show you the pennies that basically digitally come out of that mouse click and go into the pockets of someone that you probably don't like very much, because you think you're just innocently clicking, but you're paying for that guy's fucking vacation home because you're clicking on something that's pissing you off. And what you really should do is stay away from it, and that guy will go out of business. But people don't know that because they're just, why would they? They don't think about it.
Well, yeah, I mean, journalism is basically run by analytics at this point. There's no journalism left in it. I mean, we saw that precisely with Gawker as a great, you know, a great example. It's like their whole model is clicks for, you know, it's not about journalism anymore. They're not about writing anything good. They're just about making sure that analytics, that little thing keeps climbing up,
there's no money in it. They saw it with Fox News. Fox News is like you were talking about the op-eds. It's like they don't claim to be, you know, they say they're a news channel, but it's hard to tell. And they make money because it's hard to tell.
Uh-oh. We lost Brian.
We lost him.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, welcome to the Professional BadgerCast.
All right. Well, Brian's internet is a little bit spotty, but there he is.
Sorry, I got booted for a second.
He has to use Mexican voles, not even the Canadian ones.
But they're volitos. okay, so I'm sorry. You were still making your point, but... if you finish, then I'll just move on to the next bit.
Let's move on.
Okay. So, all right. So what we're looking at here, and I think that it was important that we went through this whole history of Gamergate thing, okay? Gamergate has been slammed in the media so much to the point, and I mean in every possible way, like from TV episodes. There's a movie coming out.
Right. I know.
You know,
Catherine Bigelow is doing it.
Yeah, and essentially the whole... At the center of, and all of the media outlets and everything, and at the center of it all is, it's just a gigantic libel campaign to smear it as much as possible. And yeah, there are people that use the hashtag, because anybody can use it, they just type it in there, that are, you know, using it to discredit the revolt. But at the end of the day, what the most important thing is that there's a few things going on. One is, you know, again, obviously there's like the ethics thing. Can you say goodbye to your dog? I'm gonna wait.
You watch?
Yeah.
Okay, say bye to the dog.
Bye.
That's right.
Okay.
Bye.
Sorry. Okay. Hello, sorry.
Did you hear me when I said goodbye?
The dog says goodbye, Kate. They're putting the dog down. They're killing it.
Oh no, please. I have too much to do, too much work to do.
That's right.
At least 5 years left in me. Okay, so anyway. the other thing is that, you know, not only do you have this, like I said, multiple years-long slam campaign, and there's also a dismissal. Like, people are saying, you know, well, that was bad, like, 2 years ago, but it's still going on. It's just that now, you know, people are just sort of talking about it in other social media for as long as it is allowed to happen. And there's a lot of censorship going on, and I think that's the main thing that, you know, we're fighting against is our ability to have the conversation. And actually, that was, not that I thought you were being censored, but I think that was one of the reasons why I decided to reach out, because I think that us having the ability to sit down and talk about these ideas in a plain way and not with the limits of Twitter, because it's like nearly impossible. And even Periscope doesn't work that well. I swear to God, it took like fucking 3 minutes to load up before I could talk, and I'm like chomping at the bit, you know?
Yeah.
No, but I thought, you know, if we can just have a straight up like conversation, you know, just across the interwebs, this would be far more constructive.
Okay,
and
cool.
When you look at all the stuff that that the people, not just in Gamergate, but there's actually a culture war happening right now. And it doesn't even, it's not like a lot of people who write about this stuff in articles, they make it a left-right thing. Like Gamergate's been accused of being right-wing racists and all this other shit. That's all white guys, you know. That's all bullshit. I mean, and by and large, Gamergate is a libertarian movement, because it's all about, you know, leave us alone to play our games and stop trying to smear us. And do your job. We ask you to do your job because that's why we click on your websites, right? So, and this also applies to game developers. Like, if you're going to make games for us, then that's great. Do whatever you want. But if we don't want to buy your game, don't accuse us of being bad people because of it, right? And that's also happened. I don't want to get too much into it, but as an example, the new Ghostbusters trailer came out. It was like the most, historically, the most disliked trailer on all of YouTube. Yeah. And the guy who directed it, I think, is Feig?
Yeah,
he basically said it's because the internet is full of shitty people. And never, not once did he think, maybe I have a shit movie on my hands or I just put together a really bad trailer, because, you know, it was panned by everybody. Gamergate is not composed of, like, several million people. That's not them, you know.
No, but I understand where he's coming from in the sense that, A, it was a really bad trailer. It was a very disappointing trailer. I'm not one of these Ghostbuster nuts. I was more of Indiana Jones guy, but I like Ghostbusters 1 and 2 was okay. And yeah. I was just like, yeah, that there wasn't one laugh in that trailer at all. So I think a big part of it is he put out a shitty trailer. But do I think there is a corner of the internet that is very vocal that has a real issue with the fact that Ghostbusters is now starring all female in the same way that they have a problem with the last two Star Wars, or the one in December and the one coming out this December, have women as a lead? Do I think that's a real thing? Yeah, I do think that's a real thing. Do I think that's why they hated the Ghostbusters trailer at a large level? No, I think it was because it's a shitty trailer. But I don't think his point is invalid, which is there are some fucking shitty people who can't handle the fact that their precious Ghostbusters are now, you know, ladies.
Or something else, actually, I would imagine.
What do you mean?
I mean, it's any kind of remake. If it's not, people get hinky about remakes.
Yeah,
and a bunch of other men that probably would have also gotten hate as well, especially with that trailer.
True. Oh, yeah, because they would have been like fucking like Adam Sandler and like, you know,
right,
Kevin James and shit.
Yeah, that
like,
was that's Pixels, what it would have been, right? Like, Pixels loves the remake of Ghostbusters with men.
Yeah, you know, that they wouldn't be happy with it because it would have lost its charms. But I wanted to correct something that Brian said. It's not a right versus left issue. It's a Badgers versus everyone issue.
Yeah. Or it's really more of a, essentially what we're looking at, though, really is an authoritarian versus libertarian issue. And there are people who are trying to force other people to conform to a worldview or to an ideology or to an opinion on something. And if you don't, then they accuse you of being a bad person. And then there are people who say, no, I don't have to do that. If I choose to like something, or if I choose to, you know, vote with my dollars, or I go to your website or agree with your viewpoint on something, it's because I choose to, and your desire to emotionally manipulate me with like this sort of shaming language is bullshit. And in fact, it actually creates there's so much like radiation around this issue And it's like so common. Like, you know what's going on, you know, not just in like the you know, this sort of geek sphere, but it's going on in like this college campuses, it's stuff going on in the radio, it's not just games media, it's mainstream media, the election is coming up, all this shit, right, is creating so much radiation around this sort of like this rampant authoritarian, politically correct culture that is, on the one hand, it's probably got some roots in like what could be a good-hearted intention, but thinks that it need change needs to happen yesterday, and so therefore the only way to get it is to force people to believe what we believe, and they put out content that is, you know, not just, I wouldn't say offensive so much as blatantly bigoted towards the groups of people that they feel are okay to be bigoted against, for example, men, straight people, white guys, whatever. And they think that they're being progressive. And so the resistance that comes from that is overwhelmingly strong, too, because, you know, like, bigotry is wrong no matter what direction it goes in. No matter if it's going from men to women, women to men, straight guys to gay guys to straight guys, you know, left, right, Christian, atheist, whatever. It doesn't matter. But this has become so tense that what I think happened in your case is... You made a comment that you felt was innocuous about a photo, and in the considering how much of a powder keg things are at, and a lot of it has to do with the fact that people's views are not even allowed to be presented, and they can't like just like talk plainly about it. You attracted the attention of people who were seeing these accusations flying around on every little thing, and they got really mad, and I think doubly so because they probably didn't expect it coming from somebody like you, who typically doesn't, from what I know anyway, is kind of a rebel, right? So I think that there's a few things going on, and you're looking at a combination of this culture war combined with, you know, this like this tweet that you made, which is coming from someone who I don't think they expected it to come from, and it made them really angry, and they wanted to voice their views. And I'm sure that there were people who were being, you know, really like even-keeled, and they said, well, this is why I disagree, or this is why I agree, and then you're going to have people that are just really mad, you know, and they have more time to be on Twitter, so it looks like it's maybe one side is louder than the other, you know?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot there that I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, you have priority as a guest. I wanted to build off of one of something that Brian said, but go ahead.
Okay. Well, thank you. I was going to be like... Doesn't matter. See, that's where my mind goes. I'm like, oh, I can make a really off-color joke here, which would absolutely piss off the same people I've been pissing off all day just to do that because I think it would be fun. And then I'm like, that's probably not the right thing. So anyway,
go ahead.
We piss everybody off at some point.
Yeah, now just seen the inner workings of my brain.
Hey, we're not here to make friends. We're here to tell it like it is.
No, it isn't like it is. I was going to make a stupid joke. but anyway, for the stuff Brian was saying, so I just want to respond to a couple of things. One is that, and these are all over the place, so bear with me, but one of them was that I think what I always found annoying, though, when some of the Gamergate people would reach out to me was this sense that, oh, we're doing this for you guys, for you developers, because you can't make the games the way you want to make them. And I always found that really offensive, because it's like, you know, I'm okay. I can take care of myself. You know, it's like the team can take care of itself. It's like we appreciate that the heart's in the right place, maybe. But it's like no one's going around saying I can't make games where you crawl into people's buttholes. I get to do that. You know, I get to seek out publishers with money and vision that support the kind of stuff that we want to make. And most developers feel that way. So first off, it's just this idea that the artistic vision is being stymied. I'm sure that happens in some cases, but that would happen in any case. Like if you're talking about Assassin's Creed, where they're spending well over $100 million to make a game, regardless of what the agenda is of the people with money that are choosing to send notes to the team and saying, you have to listen because we're paying this exorbitant amount of money to make this game, that's just the cost of doing creative business when you basically need that kind of finance, right? So I always found that kind of annoying because I didn't think it was an accurate representation of the way things were as a developer in the industry. It wasn't like we were being you know, silenced, and we really wanted to make games a certain way, and we couldn't because, you know, there was this leftist agenda that was telling us we couldn't. It was never the case. It's certainly not with the people I worked with and that I know in the industry. But the other part, though, that's related is, you know, this idea of I'm reading Allison's stuff at the same time, so I'm kind of all over the place. I lost my train of thought, but you were made.
The other thing besides the GGers that would come to you and say we're doing this for you, was
right.
I'm trying to help. I will say this. I mean, maybe, you know, I could see how you could be bothered by that because in general. You know, maybe you're the type of person, like, there are other game devs that are like, well, I don't care what people tell me I should or should not be doing. I'm going to do what I want anyway. But there are cases where games have been removed. I think Grand Theft Auto was banned in Australia because, you know, there was enough voices, at least in... It was banned in certain shops, I'll put it that way. It wasn't banned across the whole continent.
But Grand Theft Auto. There was a law in Australia. Like, we actually had to remove parts of God of War 1 and Twisted Metal... Because Sony was like, we don't like your vision, Jaffe. It was because there is a law in Europe or in the UK that basically says there are things that if this committee says go beyond what we want to release into our society, it will be illegal for you to release that.
Yeah.
And when I first heard about that, I'm like, you're fucking kidding me. And I'm like, nope, that's true. And in Australia, there was a law as well. Okay. So
I wasn't sure because I heard it was... I heard it was a bunch of people that came together and basically said they didn't want it in, and it was basically just pulled from Target. Or there was a game called Dead or Alive Extreme Volleyball 3, and that one was, they decided not to release it, because essentially what the Japanese devs said was, the Japanese devs said, it appears that, you know, Americans' markets don't want this game because it will be seen as too sexist. And essentially, they were getting messages from people that were not the consumers. And you can see evidence of that, even though the game itself is pretty mediocre. But the point was that it should be available to the people who wanted it. But you can see that it turned out that it wasn't the consumers saying that, but it was actually the reviewers or like the journalists or whatever were talking to the people who were giving them demos to try out or whatever. And there were a lot of issues, and so Tecmo Koei ended up not releasing the game in the States. However, there is a website called PlayAsia.com was selling the Chinese version, which I believe came in with the English subtitles, and they're selling copies of the game because on the PlayStation 4 there's like no no region limits. So it's a region-free console. So people are buying it, but they have to get it through, you know, another party outside, and I think it's more expensive for them. And so there are cases where this happens, and it's often, no, if not always, for ideological reasons. And, of course, again, it wouldn't be... I could see it from a consistency standpoint if this sort of thing was happening in the 90s where, you know, people actually... like, listened. I know that in some cases that was. Like, I think Nintendo, I don't think it was because of Jack Thompson, but in Nintendo in the 90s, when they had the Super NES version of Mortal Kombat, when you punched a guy, there was no blood, instead there was, like, sweat, right? It looked like milk.
Yeah.
But I don't think that was because of Jack Thompson. It was because Nintendo was trying to be the family-friendly console.
Yeah.
And that's fine, because that's their prerogative, you know. But it did hurt their wallets, because I think it sold better on the Sega.
It did. So I know what I was going to say too about, because I know why, because they were two very related subjects. But when you were talking about sort of the
political radiation.
The political correct atmosphere where a lot of people feel fed up with it. I think for someone like myself who can see, and I'm not saying I'm some kind of seer or visionary. Everyone can see it, but who is engaged enough and likes things from both sides, I get why people would feel that way, but I think I think to look at political correctness and the intent behind it in most cases and say it's anything other than a good thing in terms of the initial intent behind it. I don't mean where it can go, where it does become ideological and damaging. I think it's important to remember that you can, you know, plant a flag and say, I don't like the fact that people are telling me what is and isn't okay to think, while at the same time, who would like that, right? But while at the same time going, you know, just because somebody is saying something is politically correct doesn't mean you throw the baby out with the bathwater and it's wrong and your mind should just close shut. And because there are people and there are different, you know, races or sexual identities or what have you that are marginalized and have a shitty experience. It's like, I'll give you a good example. It's like, I don't like when people use the word retarded in a derogatory sense. I don't like the B word. I don't even say the B word because I think it's offensive to the world, right? I wouldn't shut someone else's views down or the ability to say those words in that way. But I think I have a right to express in the proper forum the fact that I don't find those things okay because I think they are cruel and I think they might. It's kind of like, you know, again, I have a brother who's gay. And we grew up saying the word fag and throwing the word fag around like it was nothing. And it didn't occur to me till much, much later, because I didn't know he was gay, and I didn't even really think about the word fag being a negative thing. It was just, I mean, I did, because, oh, you're a fucking fag, you know. And it was meant to be an insult. But it never occurred to me. It's like, fuck, if someone's actually gay, every day they hear that. That must make them feel like shit constantly. And is that politically correct because I want to sort of elevate the way I think to a level that doesn't hurt other people? Maybe, but I'm okay with that. There's a woman I work with, an incredibly talented concept artist. Her name's Nafisa. And I love getting into discussions and debates with her because it worked. You know, for the longest time, I was like, this is stupid. All these people complaining that Scarlett Johansson is in Ghost in the Shell just because she's not an Asian actress. I'm like, look, if I was spending $200 million on a fucking Hollywood blockbuster, I wouldn't hire an Asian actress for the lead, not because I have anything against Asian women, but because there's not one that can prove that they can open a movie.
Scarlett Johansson puts asses in seats, including her really nicely sculpted one.
Fair enough, and for the most part, I do believe that's true, and I don't believe you can point to an Asian actress that has proven yet that they can do that.
Lucy Liu's too old.
Right, that's right. And even when she wasn't, it wasn't like, what was she in, like some assassin movie or something. Yeah, it wasn't like that set the world on fire.
Well, I will say...
My point, though, is that, so I would sit with Nafisa, though, and my initial thinking was, yeah, I hear you, it sucks, but you know what? You can't name me an Asian actress that puts butts in seats. And I'm not saying I've come around, you know, 180 to her way of thinking on it, but if I hadn't sat there and listened and not thought, she's trying to oppress my right to sort of fucking hate these liberal decisions, I never would have heard her view, which I do think is a pretty compelling view. I don't necessarily know if I agree with it. My point being is I just think we have to be careful because you can push back in either direction too far and you see it, you know, that's why I don't consider myself for a lot of reasons, but I worry about a possible Trump presidency because I think it's so built on the bones of anger and vitriol and sort of just discontent that I don't really think that those people are voting for that man's individual policies. They're just voting because I think, not all of them, but a lot of them I think are voting because he is a way to express that anger. And I think it's a good anger, but I think it's throwing the baby out with the bathwater if you also assume that the political correct side is just this wimpy, stupid side that has nothing to offer the world.
Well, I wouldn't argue that that's what it comes down to. I think that what it comes down to for me and a lot of people is if it is your individual prerogative to, you know, like, to choose your words, like what you want to say and, you know, what you don't want to say and so on, I don't have a problem with that at all. I think that most people generally don't. But I think that what a lot of people generally do not like is being told what they can and cannot say. And one of the reasons why is because you kind of like you hit a bunch of pitfalls. Like, okay, so if there are certain things I can't say, who decides what those things are? Under what circumstances? Are there any double standards to this? And it becomes overly complex, and it also hands too much authority to people who, you know, you just can't easily manage that. So yeah. I think that, like, if somebody wants to use the word fag, I don't care. But if somebody else does not, I'm not going to say you have to use it. You know, like, if it's, for me, it comes down to personal, individual freedoms to or to not choose to do something. And I'm okay with that. As long as nobody's getting hurt and there's no, essentially, it's, I mean, what I mean by hurt is not feels, because, again, that's one of those things that you can't know what's going to hurt somebody's feelings or not. So that's not even something you can really, like, get into. But
I think you're too quick to dismiss that, because I think ultimately that's the underlying issue, right? I mean, I think you can very well know that a majority of a certain kind of person, in terms of whether they're a black person or a homosexual person or a straight white person or whatever, that if you use certain language, it's going to be offensive to them. It's going to be hurtful to them. And mm-hmm. So I think it's fair to say you don't care about that. I think it's fair to say I'm okay with the fact that if I want to use the word fag and somebody happens to be gay around me and they hear it and that really kind of makes them feel lesser, I'm okay with that. I think as long as you go in knowing that, but I don't think it's fair to act like that's not really worth having part of the conversation. Look, you use language that people are telling you is hurtful to them, and you choose to sort of walk away from that and not hear that, that's totally okay. I think I would never take away anyone's right to use any kind of speech, including almost especially hate speech. But to act as if people are just being too sensitive when they tell you that hurts my feelings. I have a kid who I adore with all my heart, and, you know, she like me, is ADHD, right? Well, the minute I knew she was that, and I was that, and people talk about the short bus or this or that or the other, I'm like, fuck you. This is one of the most creative kids I've ever seen in my life. She writes lyrics like a goddamn, you know, 12-year-old fucking Joni Mitchell. So back the fuck off, because it's very offensive and it's very hurtful when I hear those things, when people use those words. People should be allowed to use those words. I would defend their right to use those words. I would go to the mat for them to have the right to use those hateful words, because in America, that's sort of one of the tenets of what makes this country so great. But to act as if it's like we're being wimps and babies because we get our feelings hurt when someone says something hateful, I don't know. I don't think
that's not really what I'm making the argument for. I'm not saying that if you can't handle it, you know, you need to grow up or anything like that. I think it just comes down to, provided, you know, like you said, all speech should be okay, even hate speech. I think that that's very important, because if you're controlling people's speech and you're trying to discuss ideas, you can't really hear bad ideas if you don't allow the speech to happen.
You're right.
There's a story of a guy, a homosexual man, who wrote a book about his life, I believe, and essentially it was during a period where gays were very much not accepted. And when I say gays, I mainly am talking about gay men. Were not accepted, you know, in at all in most of the Western world, period, probably Eastern world too. And it was thanks to the fact that he was actually, because the people that were arguing against him were using foul language, they were, you know, they were saying all these bad things, and there were people on his side that said, man, you don't need to listen to that shit. We're not going to give them a platform. We're not going to let them come to our, you know, rallies or debate us or whatever. And the guy said, no, 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 no. We have to. This is extremely important, especially because they're bringing out these really bad ideas. If people can hear them, and I put my case out there, and that guy puts his case out there, then the argument wins. And it doesn't come down to, you know, the tone policing or the language policing or the you know, the triggers and the safe spaces and all that shit, because when you start putting all of that, and that's totalitarian in a nutshell,
I'm confused, though, because I agree with that 100%.
Uh-huh.
But doesn't that run counter to the fact that you're saying you're behind Gamergate aspects where they want to hurt companies that are expressing views and doing business in a way that they don't like by causing advertisers to leave them in order to get those companies to fall apart. Wouldn't you just say, let Kotaku be Kotaku? They'll slit their own fucking throats. Why would you?
Well,
No.
What Gamergate is doing, because this is actually volunteerism. It's a voluntary action, because what Gamergate did when they were writing the emails, and I've written some myself, was they weren't saying you better remove your advertising or else. They were saying, I am writing to tell you that I'm not going to be going to this website anymore, and these are the reasons why I'm doing it. And I want you to know because you advertised for them.
But to what end, though? Why would you write the letter? Why not just stop going to the website?
Well, because
money counts. Money talks. But sadly, you have to affect things with your dollars.
Okay, but I don't think that's necessarily wrong. I'm just saying that runs counter to the story you were just telling about the guy that sounded like you agreed with, not you, but Brian,
right,
about the guy who said, look, we have to give the hate speech a platform because it will basically, they'll give them enough rope, they'll hang themselves publicly, and we have to be able to have that speech out there so we can have the debate and the argument. And on the other hand, you're saying money talks, which means you're basically saying money talks, meaning that if we complain enough and pull our eyeballs, they will pull their advertising.
The other part of it...
Hang on, let me finish.
Okay.
And thus, they won't be able to continue to write the way they're writing and express themselves the way they choose to. So those ideas can't live together, can they?
Can I interject something real quick?
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, part of it was the fact that a lot of the things that these people were writing were, they were liable. It was untrue. So the only recourse in a lot of cases was to tell advertisers that, you know what, I am going to basically withdraw my funds or my support of these websites because the things they are doing are libelous or they are damaging.
Libelous, that's illegal. You could sue them.
Well, who's going to sue them, though? That's the thing. It's like, Gamergate wasn't an organization.
The person who's getting slandered or libeled against. I mean,
Gamergate is a hashtag, though, so it's kind of, you're getting into a weird area. That's what I'm saying. It's a much more nuanced kind of conversation, I think.
But let's have a nuanced conversation. I mean, Alice is talking about how her name was dragged through the mud, her earning potential was harmed, and she has evidence and proof, and she can show the plaque, and she can show the audio from the lecture, and she can show the contract. Yeah. I'm not saying you didn't. I'm saying that would be the, when you say, what's our recourse? The recourse is to take the fuckers to court and say, look, you guys fucked me, and this is the punitive damages because of my earning potential that's been damaged by you basically libeling me. Public,
and that is happening.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's what I was going to say. When you say
what is our only recourse, that's your recourse.
In the case of Gamergate, as Scott was saying, because it's a hashtag, there's no recourse in that sense. So this is their recourse to doing that. I mean, you could argue that what I'm doing. I'm not going after libel, it's injurious falsehood. But what I'm doing is also exerting a censorship because of the situation that I've gone through. At the same time as you can say, yeah, let people have the right to speak, you don't necessarily have, like, you can challenge their right to authority, which is, I think, what this really is. We're challenging the right of media to have authority over the speech or be the authority. It's different. They're not just a Ku Klux Klan rally screaming about black people. They have an authority. People who read them believe that we are misogynists. They believe that I'm a harasser. You know, they believe that they have an authority. That's what we're going after, is their authority. Not necessarily their speech. They can continue to have their speech, but if people stop giving that speech authority, then we take the gun out of their hand, so to speak. And that's what I see Gamergate doing. And yeah, they are going after the advertisers, but there's also an element here as well. These media outlets are supposed to serve them as a consumer to an extent. They should also serve the developers and the marketplace as well.
Because they are. They're making revenue off of their business. They are serving someone, or they would be out of business. They're certainly not serving me. They're certainly not serving me because I don't go to those sites anymore. But they're serving someone or they'd be out of business.
Okay. Well, this is the point. When they send the letters that to they are actually indicating what the market feels about those groups or that those outlets.
I don't know if that's true. I think ultimately they might be indicating what a vocal majority or minority feels about those groups, but ultimately it's do you continue to go to their sites?
I know,
but I'm saying that do enough people agree with the movement that is Gamergate when it comes to this individual issue that it changes their consumer behavior? And if it does, you win. If it doesn't...
But the thing is that if it's effective, if these letters are effective, and we're getting into tactics now.
Well, why not get into tactics? The problem with this conversation is I want to get into
tactics. No, it's just endless.
I want to get into tactics because that's where
I want to go to bed.
Okay, well, I mean, choose your priority.
We can do a to be continued, but what I would also add this is if Gamergate could grow its numbers, then they could probably have or... they could, in the future, use their ability to not go to a website in order to give the effect that you want. Unfortunately, the only way that people will, that Gamergate could have grown as a consumer revolt is if more people knew that Gamergate existed in the form that it was intended, in what it's supposed to be, which is, you know, what it's always been about. But when the common person, if you tell a regular normal gamer or regular person, hey, have you heard about Gamergate? You should look it up. If they do, they're going to get the version of the story the media wants them to know. So they're going to be like, well, I don't want anything to do with this. So that's going to, it's almost like if you're, when it comes to like freedom of speech in a forum like ours right now, we both have a platform we can speak our views. I can't silence you, and you can't silence me, or at least if you did, the only way you could do it is by...
And I wouldn't want to, just for the record.
Right, of course not. But in the case of... In the Gamergate case, that would be the equivalent of, sure, we can both talk, but I have, you know, a gigantic megaphone, and you have to do it with a kazoo and your knowledge of Morse code. And we have to...
It's not the same. The scale is completely different. It is not the same, but you know what? It's never the same. It's never the same when you've got a presidential election and you've got someone like Bernie Sanders or Barack Obama or even Donald Trump who's coming into this. They're not the establishment, although Trump has all the money in the world to spend, and that's a different topic, which I'd love to get into at some point, but not Trump, but the idea of the whole campaign finance issues. But the point being, though, is that it's like, you know, sorry, it's not the same. Sorry, you just have a kazoo. You know what? Learn to fucking play the kazoo really well, and you.
Yeah, and they did.
Okay, well, and you well, they didn't play it well enough.
Well, actually, like I said, they got a lot done.
Yeah, they did get a lot done. Considering what they were up against, I've seen much more worse turnouts than that.
Wait, what are you? Are we? Just to be clear, are we talking about Gamergate or Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders?
No, Gamergate.
Okay. No, absolutely. Yeah. Okay, I see. No, but, I mean, go ahead.
There was one thing I wanted to bring up in relation to your talk about language and recognizing that it hurts people. Now, something that I noticed, and actually I noticed because my husband got really, really feisty about it when he was listening to you, is you said that what happened to me at the end of it, and it did affect me, you said you need to recognize that's the way the world is, which is essentially saying, you know, you can't sit in that pain. Wouldn't it be more sensible to tell people, if there's a word that causes you pain, why don't you take the power out of that word and move away from that? Like, because I was in pain from this experience that I had, and you said you need to move away from that pain and expect, you know, do something, move out of it, become stronger or process it, and don't let it affect you.
Don't let it affect you, but I do think there is a time to sort of be affected and mourn it and be pissed off about it.
But do you think the same thing about people with harsh language? Like you use the term fag, Is it possible for people to do the same? Is to take the power of the word away and to stop being affected by it? And the other thing that I wanted to point out with those words and with a lot of the internet culture which I've come to understand is that now that fag pretty much applies to everyone, like even cats, it really doesn't apply to gay people anymore. They have to actually... Sorry?
Yeah, what do you call it? A cat fag or a feline fag or something?
I don't know. It's whatever.
I'm going to wait for the chat. They're going to tell us. It applies to cats.
Okay, so my answer to that would be ask the people who were affected. I don't take personal... I do now because I have people in my family who are gay, but I don't take offense when someone uses the word fag because it's not insulting me personally, but my brother's right here. Philip, do you take offense when people use the word fag in a derogatory way? Like, yeah. Oh, you're a fucking fag, dude. They don't mean you're a homosexual. They mean you're doing something stupid.
Of course I do.
Okay, so, you know, when is the time to walk away is when the people who are affected by it say, we're good with it. So when African Americans or black people say the N-word ending with an A, if black people choose to use it that way, that's okay for us. I say, you know what? I don't fucking know what your life is like, so...
But here's my point. Here's the point that I'm trying to get to. When you use it for a behavior that anybody can evince, or as a derogatory for anyone, that means that it doesn't specifically refer to gay people. It just becomes a insult.
You are not wrong.
But at the same time, I hear what
you're saying, but you're making this assumption that that has been decreed and post it up on the consciousness of the world, and everybody agrees with you, okay? But I don't think if you ask people, I just asked, I got a sample of one just now. I asked a gay person.
Yeah, but you said in a derogatory fashion. Well, how about the use of...
It's like, ah, this candy tastes great.
Let's take a page out of, I think, 4chan. Old fag. That is actually an honorific.
I don't even know what that means. What is that?
That means
an old fag, I think, means somebody who's been on 4chan for a while. I don't know too much about it, but I believe that's...
It's almost a term of fact now, I think.
Okay, but that's wonderful that you see it that way.
I don't see anything anyway. I'm presenting a possible interpretation of this situation. If you
I disagree with you. I would say that until the people who tell me that they are offended and hurt by it, I appreciate that when you say someone rides the short bus. Okay, let me tell you something right now. When I'm even starting to say that sentence, and I get a little emotional because I hate the fact that there are kids out there that are amazing, and they get picked on and made fun of for whatever reason. And that I get emotional about that, I'm sorry, but that's how I feel. And so for you to say that, oh, well, the power has been removed from that word, Jaffe, don't worry about that, says you. But I'm telling you...
Okay, back up. I'm doing a theoretical thought construct.
Sure,
I'm not saying that necessarily we've gotten to that point, but what happens if you get to that point?
If you get to that point, then it might as well be the word bottle cap. One's going to have the conversation
exactly.
About it.
Exactly. Wouldn't great. That be the better way to do it? Just get that word to the point where it doesn't, it's so
how
generic,
that,
nobody cares.
How does that occur, though? How do you consciously take a word
I,
in
I don't
the,
know, but the thing is...
Work that.
Well,
it's an internet culture thing. I don't
know. Well, I think in a way it's happening. Let's look at it this way. And this sort of thing takes time, but... I remember a time on television where nobody would say the word ass, and now if you don't hear it on TV, it's weird. Like, it has no power anymore. It used to be something that if someone said ass on television, like, I mean, maybe black and white TV, you know, that was, oh, what? You know, and I mean, whatever happened,
frankly,
I don't know who the first
dear,
person to say
damn, right?
What?
It's like, frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn. My mom.
Yeah, exactly.
People
it's
went
like
to the
that.
Movies just to hear that word because it was
yes.
so shocking.
Yes, and exactly, or like asshole, or you know, whatever. The, yeah. All the curse words that are on television today, and I mean like network TV, that was stuff that you would never hear on TV. Yeah. And after a while, essentially, I guess what happened is over time, the word lost power. And now it doesn't have that power. And I think that eventually, in the internet culture, is probably going to have an effect on this. In a couple of generations, I'm guessing that a lot of these words will probably lose power. Now, for now, I think that, yes, to a degree, we have to navigate. So when I say, you know, I don't want to stop anyone from using language,
I don't either.
It doesn't mean that those people should be as callous as they, you know, as they want to all the time. I think that they should just do whatever they want to do. But one of the things that I think that is beneficial is an individual's ability to choose. So if someone is policing their language because there is a mandate to police their language, and so they have to, is that the same as someone who has the freedom to use whatever language they want, but they choose not to do it? And
absolutely,
I think
it is not the same, and I agree with you. I think here's what I would say. In the same way that I would choose not to listen to racist people talk negatively about minority groups, but I would still defend their right, you know, to say it, I would also choose not to go to websites like Kotaku, but I would absolutely defend their right to exist and not have advertising dollars removed because people don't like what they're having to say, because that's policing them in the exact same way. And I'm sorry that you can't see that, but it is.
Yeah. And the thing is, if you police people and you restrict them and you tell them they can't do something or express themselves openly, and you keep doing that, and I'm not saying you're doing this, I'm saying like if people do this, it actually makes people more inclined to do more radical and outrageous shit because they're being told they can't do it. And so, you know, I think that when people have the freedom, they tend to, they actually tend to be more conservative about the words they use when they have the freedom, because it doesn't have, like, it's not as, you know, edgy anymore. It's just not as edgy.
I'm offended by the fact that I'm still awake.
All right. So anyway, my goals were this, and we'll just really quick. My goals were, I wanted to hopefully talk to you about, you know, what had happened, and to get some clarification, but also hopefully, like, you know, we could discuss why it happened, because I think that what we're looking at, and this is like where I ended before, is, you know, a really tense sort of atmosphere around this culture war. And I have, like, links, if you want to, I can send them to you, for all of the work that Gamergate has done, if you're curious.
Yeah,
although this wasn't about GG, but, you know, we ended up talking about it. And then I got one last thing. Make your case quickly, so for people who don't know, why you thought the photo was sexist.
Okay, so I think the picture, now let me ramble a bit more, I think the people in the picture are probably, there's no indication the individuals in the picture, the men or the women, are sexist. There's no indication the person taking the picture was sexist, and there was a sexist intent. Okay, so let's first be clear about that. I think the picture is sexist in that it is a reflection of a societal norm that I consider sexist, okay, which is basically that the men are always the heroes, the men are the ones that are thoughtful and thinking about going off on the big special mission, and if you look at the picture, they're all kind of looking up at the sky in the same position as if they're pondering something important, and the women are basically not the actual superheroes. They're not the ones, they're the ones who are smiling and looking really pretty, and sort of nurturing the men. Now, do I think anything is wrong with that? Absolutely not. Do I think as a culture, though, that is not a way that people act, but the way people are invisibly, subconsciously conditioned to act, in that is sort of the norm and the right way to do it? I think that's a sexist attitude, and I think it hurts. It's the same, like I said, my you know, it's the same thing that kept Rey as an action figure off the shelves, that kept Black Widow as an action figure off the shelves. It's the reason my kid likes to watch Supergirl with me but doesn't really sit down and watch The Flash with me, because those types of characters are underrepresented, and in doing so and in being that way, it seeps into the culture and into the way we behave and into the way that women and men, people always thought I was like, I would got so frustrated because people were like, oh, you're trying to defend me. I don't need you to defend me. I can defend myself. I'm a strong woman. I'm not trying to defend women. I'm not saying it's sexist against women. I'm saying it's a sexist view regardless. Maybe there's a guy who wants to be the nurturer who doesn't want to be the hero. Maybe he likes more, like I was saying earlier, like the Pepper Potts role and wants the woman to be the Tony Stark, right? It's not a sexist against women and pro-men kind of thing. It's just a sense of I feel that that is a sexist mentality that is insidious, and it is very hard to root out and hard to acknowledge exist, and thus it manifests itself in ways that I don't think are good, but I could be wrong. But that's what I felt, and that's what I feel, and you know, we can discuss that. But it's okay. The thing that I took issue with. So there's a lot of people who didn't even want to have that conversation.
All right.
Well, Scott, yeah, we'll have that conversation. Yeah. We will have that conversation here.
If I can interject. Oh, I'm sorry, Allison. You're going.
Well, I think that you were next. So go ahead.
Oh, that's fine. Well, this is just real quick. I because I wanted to kind of prepare a little bit for this and kind of know a little bit more about this, I actually went and looked at the photographer's Instagram and some of his other accounts where he had some of these pictures posted.
Cool.
And if you look at the series of pictures, I think the ones that I was just at a very cursory glance able to find, there were about like 8 or 9 pictures total that I found. Yeah. And if you look at them, it doesn't like, and again, this is just my opinion. You're entitled to yours.
Sure.
But when I'm looking at them, I'm not really seeing this as a sexist thing because, like, there's all manner of pictures, and quite frankly, most of them are just the girls by themselves. So they are, in essence, and this may sound kind of corny, but they are the hero of the picture. They are the main focus of the picture. So there's a pretty dramatic range of what you're seeing in these galleries.
Okay, but you, and that may be the case. I'm sure it is. But like I said, I don't think there was any sexist intent. But that picture...
Oh, I understand what you're saying, though. It's like a systemic thing.
Well, yeah, but that picture that I tweeted was the front picture, was the only picture, if I recall, that the Huffington Post, that gets tens of millions of views every day, if not more, chose to put and write about. And so that was the picture that I was tweeting about, and that was the picture I found reflected sexist ideals and ideas that exist in our society. It's not that you... like I said, I don't think it was a sexist intent. I think it's so under the floorboards that no one even thought about it. And even if they did think about it, that's okay if they chose to go ahead with it. But you could show me, for all I know, the photographer's the fucking Dalai Lama. But it doesn't change the fact that that individual photo is what I was tweeting about based on the fact that that was what the Huffington Post put as one of their main news stories.
Right. Well, I would just say, just to give people an overall understanding of things, there's more to this than what is seen. Obviously, the Huffington Post is showing just they are focusing on that one particular image. But there's a larger story there, though. And you have said that, like in your Periscope, you actually mentioned some things regarding that there's probably more going on here. And then it's not in a singularly intent thing that it was like these people were doing this because of, like, it's more of a systemic thing is what I think you were kind of getting at.
I think that's a great way to put it. That's exactly right.
Okay. And to speak to one more thing, there have been, like, I'm kind of an action figure nerd. That's why I used to work for Destructoid, because I used to work for one of their other sites. But there are and there have been multitudes of, I know this is such a dumb little thing to talk about, but there's multitudes of female action figures out there. The raping was a very specific instance, and I understand what you're talking about.
Well, Black Widow,
Marvel Universe figures, there have been Black Widow figures, there have been
but when the Avengers came out, that there was not...
Oh, the film, right in that line. Well, and just to give a little bit of context to that...
Because they don't sell.
Yeah, well, to give a little context to that, though, historically... Female figures have just not sold as well, so it was just a matter of they were either short packed or they just weren't included in the line. So, just to give a little bit of context to that. So.
Right, and again, I don't think anyone at Disney was sitting there going, "I hate
of course.
Not include this figure."
Yeah,
that yes, it makes sense that it's not selling, so let's not spend the money to put a figure out that historically hasn't sold. Mm-hmm. But I do think it is a systemic problem, as you're saying, which is there's a reason it hasn't historically sold because we haven't told stories about that particular group of people in a way that is compelling enough to merit wanting a fucking action figure. I mean, do you really want to go out and buy the action figure from you know, whoever the female lead was from Men in Black, what, Linda, whatever the fuck her name was? No.
Right.
Because she didn't have anything interesting to do in the movie.
But yeah, no, just, and as a side note, Bruce Timm actually talks about this too, because they talked about that as far as like some of the toy lines that were associated with the shows that he did, where they had talked about that, you know, where they wouldn't produce the figures, like the higher ups in the hierarchy of the business, they wouldn't do it because they just didn't sell. So I'm kind of with you.
They basically considered it a liability.
Well, it wasn't a liability. It was just you know, putting resources towards something that's not going to see a return. So,
yeah.
But yeah, no, I understand what you're saying.
But it is cyclic thinking, because if you go, oh, well, you know, female leads don't open movies, although they do if you look at Wanted, if you look at Lucy. But I understand that historically it's not as strong as movies that open action films with men. But ultimately there comes a point where you have to say, okay, well, let's make something that, you know, like J.J. Abrams did with Star Wars, or like,
Another aspect of it too is that I think the landscape has changed very, very quickly, and these companies haven't adapted to it.
Yeah, that's correct.
That's another wrinkle. But yeah, you know.
Yeah. Let me just say one final thing, because I know it's late and I feel bad that Allison's still awake. Because when we're talking about the culture feeling that they are. Or at least a percentage or a group of the culture feeling that they are not being heard, or that they're being policed, or that they're being told how to think. You know, it's like, you know, I don't know if one of the groups on the left or the right just has to plant a flag and say enough, but it can't be that hard for some people who are today complaining that they're being told how to think and that the world is too politically correct, to remember back 8 years and 10 years ago when anyone that opposed the Republican and conservative war was a traitor, and that the Dixie Chicks didn't belong on the radio anymore because the lead singer said one thing about George Bush, right? Mm-hmm. It does go back and forth and back and forth, and maybe the problem is it's like, now that Obama's out of office, maybe the people who have felt unheard in his presidency feel, ha, fuck it, now it's our time. Just like people that were liberal and left-leaning for 8 years of George W. Bush felt like, Jesus fucking Christ, we can't even tell you that a war that we think is wrong without being told that we're un-American? You know, maybe it's just, it's someone's got to fucking stop it, because it just keeps going.
Well, yeah, there's a pendulum swing that happens, you know. It happens with the generations. It happens in our pop culture. It's happened in art movements throughout history. Every time a new one comes, it rebels against the one before it, and sometimes it swings too far. And there has to be somebody to put the brakes on it and say, okay, you know, we get it. You really don't want to do whatever the previous generation / art movement / whatever did. But sometimes it is actually, I think that there's a combination. It's both, the pendulum can swing too far, but the pendulum does have to swing. Because sometimes if one side of a given issue becomes, they get too big, they get too fat, they start asking for things that are unreasonable. So you have to keep them, it has to be a constant tension between these two forces. That's always happening. It's at least two. Most of the time, it is just two.
I think that is a great, great point and a great way to put it. I wish though that we could just be more aware of that, so it didn't have to get so emotional and mean.
The emotional part is the hardest part to sort of, you know, stave off, because it's where we want to go first. Yeah. And a lot of times that is rage, but it's also, you know, we have done a whole lot of shows about this shit. A whole lot. So if you ever want to come back, we can talk about other things and, like, really get into it.
Cool. Yeah, that sounds fun.
But I think that we have really gone far into it. And Allison is, she's peeking in, like, are we done yet? Or do you want to say something? Or what? Allison?
No, I just wanted to say, I mean, there is a lot to unpack with this talk about. I would say it's more gender roles and sexism that are in the picture. There's the rabbit hole goes very deep. But one of the things that I would point out is when you have female characters and female action heroes, part of the thing that makes them less interesting is because the consequences aren't as severe to them as it is for male action heroes. The physical consequences, the likelihood of death, the likelihood of being injured, dismembered, so you don't get that sense of danger. And then the other thing is that because women are perceived to be more morally better, I guess, or more...
like the moral center.
Yeah, the moral center. You don't get that kind of that moral tension that a lot of anti-heroes get, too, like male anti-heroes.
I hear that. I think that's a really good point. The first point you make makes me wonder, though, that are you suggesting that just pure practicality, if you're going to have a fight scene with Black Widow and after the fight scene is over, like in, I don't know if you've seen the new Civil War, but there's a sequence where Tony Stark just got his face all pulped up and shit because he got the crap kicked out of him. Are you suggesting that if we saw Scarlett Johansson with that kind of aftermath of the action sequences, that that would allow us to embrace her more as an action hero?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that when heroes make sacrifices,
she doesn't even get the amount of damage that I get when I was doing sparring and martial arts.
I don't have a problem with it, but why? I've never even thought about that, and that kind of goes to the whole thing about how insidious all this is. It's never occurred to me to think about that.
Yeah,
why do you think that is? Do you think people would just find it?
That's the horns of the dilemma, because if you start showing that, people will get offended.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. Like, there are people who get offended, and in general, people are a little bit uncomfortable when they see women get, like, physically hurt. You know, and so we have to see a hero like Black Widow as much as an agent in her world. When I say an agent, I don't mean like a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent. I mean like a person of agency in her world, capable of essentially taking the same kinds of risks that the males are taking, but not be uncomfortable when we see the cost of that. And I think that in general, it's a human thing. We have a hard time seeing women hurt in the same extent that we're willing to see men. And that also applies to children. Like, you know, if you really want to, like, mess with somebody, you know, have a kid get killed in a movie. It almost never happens. But when it does, it's like, holy shit, especially when you're a parent, right? That's tough. Like, I remember Pet Sematary, little boy comes out on the street and the semi-truck hits him. See, nobody forgets that. That's because it's a big deal. But yeah, with women too. And essentially, we are predisposed to uncomfortable. Not want to see it, yeah.
If someone in the chat put it, it's just there's not enough of a sense of danger for us to really buy in. And you know, it was just at the risk of being indulgent. I recently had a conversation with somebody who was reading, I'm trying to novelize my comics now because the amount of work that I'm doing makes it very difficult to draw. But he was reading the comics and the novel, and he said something really interesting about the female character that I had created. He said, you know, you can really tell that she's earned, like she doesn't just talented, but that she's earned her skills. And I was like, you know, how did you figure that out from the comic? And we went into a back and forth, and it actually came out like the why he had actually gotten to that conclusion. Is because throughout the entire first two volumes, you see her the opening shot, she's bleeding from a head wound, and she's fixing something in the spaceship, because it's a science fiction. And then she's like it progressively like taking like physically damaged, and you can see that she's still focused on doing her task, doing her job, fixing things, even through very serious physical damage. And she keeps doing it, like there's at least two situations where she's in a very, very dangerous situation. She's physically injured, and she's still working at her job. And I realized, and we through the back and forth with that reader, I realized that that's where he got the impression that she had earned her skills. Was because
I've never really thought about it. I think that's a great point, and I think it sounds it may take, like anything else, the change may come first from more indie action heroes and stuff that start to make it more acceptable. I mean, I think about the last Tomb Raider, not the one that just came out on Xbox, but the one that came out on, you know, a couple years ago, where there was a bit of uproar. You know, I did fine, not because it was a woman, just because I thought it was like some of the sort of Dragon's Lair style deaths when she's parachuting, I thought were pretty stupid. But I did think that she felt more like a badass because she got the shit kicked out of her and she grew from that experience. And I really liked that character. And so I think you have a wonderful point. It's never even occurred to me to think about. So I appreciate that.
Yeah, you know, here's an example of a movie that does it well. Well, Aliens is one, Terminator 2 is another one, and Kill Bill is a really good example.
Oh, yeah, and you know what? Me and my oldest, my 12-year-old and I were watching Kill Bill Volume 1, and yeah, she does. She gets the shit kicked out of her, but she's
but the reward is that much sweeter, right?
Oh, yeah.
Because you knew the stakes were high. But when you watch, like, let's say you watch a movie like any of the Resident Evil movies, or Lucy, which is a Scarlett Johansson one.
Yeah,
You're not going to, but you're just like, she's going to be fine. Her hair is going to be perfect by the time it's over.
Yeah,
and it is.
Well, okay, but the truth of the matter is, in Lucy, though, think about it, though. I mean, think about how awful she ends up. She ends up black. And who wants to be black?
What?
I'm kidding. I just wanted to give you a clickbait headline for your show.
Oh,
but she does, though. She ends up as a big thing of black goo, right?
It's a she turns into pudding or something. I don't know.
It was really stupid.
Venom from Spider-Man.
There you go.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, my God. Right. Flashbacks. Anyway, so let's just wrap it up here. But, you know, again, I want to thank you, Dave, for coming on and talking to us about this. I hope that... you know, you'll maybe come back again. I don't know. We'll talk about other shit.
Always fun.
Awesome, awesome. And I want to thank Allison for hanging in there. It is 1:48 where I am. So
I want to sleep.
And thank you, Scott, for coming on short notice. And thank you guys in the chat for coming. Leave your comments, whatever, you know, whatever your feels are about shit. And I love to read them. And, yeah, thanks for coming on this sudden emergent fireside chat, and we'll see you guys later in the week.